I'm Karen, coordinator of the San Fernando Valley Patriots, and today's speaker is Dr. Pamela Brown, economics professor from Pierce College, and she will be speaking to us today on Constitutional Economics 301, the role of free market principles, fiscal responsibility in constitutionally limited government.
Hello, everyone. My name is Pam Brown. I'm a professor at Pierce College in Woodland Hills, and I teach economics at Pierce College. I'd like to introduce you today to the relationship between government and the economy. Most people think of the economy as just a resource system where we allocate resources and produce goods and services. But the government has a critical role in the economy. The government protects property rights and it enforces contracts formed in the economy, in the marketplace. So it does not have a trivial role. But there are times when government can actually intervene too much and destroy people's incentives to work hard. So we need some government, but we don't want too much government intervention. And I'd like to go through some basic principles today with you. And I'm using my handout to guide me because I tend to ramble on quite a bit. I am mainly reaching out to liberals, collectivists, and socialists when I talk to my students, because most business majors have some feeling for the benefits of free enterprise. It's not that free enterprise gives you profits as a businessman, but it gives consumers choices. Competition is good for the consumers more than the supply side of the economy. And that benefit is little understood among collectivists. They mistrust private businesses. They think of the free enterprise system as corrupt and basically amounting to crony capitalism. And everyone here today, I think, understands the difference between a free voluntary market and corrupt crony capitalism. In a free market, individuals choose the goods and services that they would like to purchase voluntarily. Under crony capitalism, who picks the winners? The government, the interest groups. And that is not a free enterprise system. That's not a decentralized voluntary economy. That's socialism. So there are many ways to reach across the aisle. And I'm a uniter, not a divider. So I do like to communicate with people who think government's the solution to many things. And I say, no, let's slow down for a moment. In my handout, on page one, I go through a few principles that I'd like to discuss today. These are things we've already covered in our past meetings together, but we have new people here, so I'll just quickly go through them. If you want to take a little nap right now, that's fine, because you've probably heard this before, but it doesn't hurt to repeat. On page one, I just want to point out that we all need resources to survive, and there are really only three ways to get the resources that we need, the wealth we need to live, because we do need food, water, housing every day. You can produce with your own effort and then trade with people who have specialized in other things. You can steal from people. That's one way to get resources. Or you can rely on voluntary charity. And there's only so much of that to go around, because people work and they have to provide for themselves. Now, in a trading society, people exchange things they don't need very much for things they really do need much more urgently. So when you exchange with people, you get more value than you give up, and both parties gain from that exchange. So we encourage trading as economists, because when people trade, they get something very valuable. It motivates them to work really hard so they can produce and trade again. When you have a lot of stealing going on, people just stop producing. If I'm growing oranges in my backyard, and they're constantly stolen by someone, I have very little incentive to keep producing. Now, when we go for a trading economy, or a free exchange, free trade economy, the government has a role in that system. It has a defensive function. It protects your property rights to keep what you've produced. Because we did pass the 13th Amendment abolishing slavery. So one function of government is a protective function. The force the government uses is defensive, not offensive. But does government at times today protect you or steal from you actively? To give bailouts, subsidies, farm subsidies. So government is limited in a voluntary free enterprise system, but we can see it takes on other roles. Now, if the government is protecting your rights to work hard and prosper, people think, well, you know, it does protect my rights, but I want it to give me stuff as well. if it's giving you stuff, is it protecting people's rights? So you can't have both. It's either protecting your rights, which means it can't give you stuff other people produced. If it's giving you things, it's not protecting your rights. Now, we cannot create new rights out of rights violations. If you want access to housing or health care, which means the government's paying for it, other people, is that a new right or is that a violation of rights? So let's not get confused here. But you do see these things packaged in a certain way. Well, I have a right to health care. No, you have a right to work really hard to earn the money for health care insurance. That's what you have a right to. Now, I want to say something. I know we have lots of veterans here today. I love you all. There are worse things in life than being poor, sick, or living in a nursing home or in a trailer park. And there are worse things than being poor and sick or dying. And the worst things are violating other people's economic freedoms. Did you understand what I just said? As people who have served in the military know so well, they give their life so that you can be free to work hard and keep the products of your labor. So there are worse things than being poor. Live a life of honor. But that concept has been lost in our modern economy today. There are two things the government should do in a free market system. It should provide collective goods we all use, like highways and national defense, a levy to stop floods hitting the town. When I give the government money, I don't expect to be scammed. I expect some actual goods and services in exchange for those tax dollars. These are things we can't buy on our own, like a car or a hamburger. We have to pay for those collectively. So there are a few collective goods we all pay for through taxation. And then, of course, the Army is there and the courts to protect our contracts in the marketplace. So we do agree there's a place for government. Government is not in the business of enslaving people or allowing slavery to happen. Is that a voluntary exchange or is that theft of labor when you enslave someone? That's not a voluntary, so that would be a violation of your rights. The government's there to prevent slavery. It's there to prevent pollution, which can cause negative effects on your neighbor. You don't throw the trash over the yard of your neighbor's fence. You take care of your own trash. Now, there is controversy about global warming, and I have a website in the back here called surfacestations.org, and they show that the weather stations are out of compliance around the United States. They have like a light bulb right next to the thermometer. So if truly global warming is happening, we don't want to shut down the economy if the data is not right. So you got to check out that website. It's hilarious. So pollution is something the government should take care of, assuming it's genuine. And corporate welfare is not an essential function of government. 80% of businesses are going to fail in their first 5 years. The government's not there to bail them out, because the 20% that succeed are going to expand, like Stonefire Grill, and the people who lost their jobs will just be absorbed by the 20% that grow. So these are price signals. To me, profit and loss is a price signal of better products. It's not for the government to pick the winners. The customers, the consumers do that. Equality, to me, means we all have 24 hours in a day. Equality doesn't mean we all earn the same income or that you take the neurosurgeon's money because you're a sign spinner. Okay. Equality means we all have 24 hours every day. We can choose leisure time and we can go to the beach, or we can put the real estate signs out in the morning at 7 a.m. on Sundays and work more. So some people are rich in leisure time and some people are rich in material things. We can all be rich. You just have to allocate that equal amount of time. So when someone says, oh, he's really fortunate and privileged to be rich, I said, well, let's just look at what he does. Oh, I see. It's Ben Carson, the neurosurgeon. Well, is he fortunate? Is he just privileged? Or did he sacrifice a lot? And I tell my union friends, you don't want to exploit people, because if they work more hours, they need to be paid more. See what I just did there? Yeah, you saw that. The economy is an expanding pie. So this is a concern I have with people who are anti-free enterprise. They think of the economy as a fixed pie, and if you get more, I got less, and it never grows. So this view of the economy as never expanding is a fallacy, and if it does expand, and it can expand, we can all have more if we just work hard. But they think of it as, well, he got more. My husband says, the rich guy got up early and got out the money rake, and he raked it in before I overslept. But in fact, if we all take an advanced skill, a high-yield skill, whether it's neuroscience or plant genetics or agricultural engineering, software design, we can actually get more out of the resources we have. And I have some examples in here where a farmer used GPS to map his field, and it was only $30,000 for the software. And now he knows exactly where to use fertilizer, which is made out of crude oil. It's very expensive. So now he doesn't have to spend as much on crude oil, which frees that up for other things like air conditioning. So we're using the same resources or less just by new technologies. So if we all go into a technology that helps get more out of the resources we have, we actually see the pie expanding. And that's a concern I have. You see liberals talking about like Agenda 21 and one child per family policies. Now, they're coming at that because they think of it as a fixed pie. And it can't grow, so we just have to divide it up fairly. Make sure you don't have too many kids or whatever. But so that's what that mentality of a zero-sum economy leads to. We have to control the whole economy because, you know, we're going to run out of stuff. Are we really? And then on the back of page one, we went over that last time. It just shows you the two systems for allocating resources, capitalism and socialism. And I don't include crony capitalism under the capitalism diagram. That's not part of a free economy. I'm not going to go through that today. We have done that in the past. But it's just a short summary. And as you can see, there are pluses and minuses to both systems. Capitalism, we have rapid innovation, and socialism, you do have a guaranteed job. When you work at that state-run factory, you're always guaranteed a job. Or the state-run farm under collectivization where the government runs all the factories. But is there any competition among companies? No, it's like everyone works for the government. And if you want to become a singer and go on, you know, the American Idol, but the pig farmer just retired, guess where you're going to work, comrade? Under socialism. Are you going to be able to be a free enterprise individual entrepreneur? You're going to work at the pig farm. So there's good and bad to the systems, and to me, the huge benefits of freedom outweigh the security of socialism. But people don't remember those benefits. They think, oh, we're just going to nationalize everything. Are you really? Then we'll be poor, and it's also immoral because we'll be the slave of the government. On page two, I just have a few points here about the microeconomics of freedom. Again, income inequality is not in social injustice. It's a price signal of what consumers want. It's a signal of where you should be going with your resources, and it's a signal of how difficult a skill is to acquire. The more costly and time-consuming the skills, the more income you'll earn for that sacrifice. Free trade, to me, is a human right. The government doesn't produce things and put them on the shelf for you to buy. I decide who I trade with. I respect people. I respect their decisions about where to work, what line of work to go into, and how to allocate those work products. At no time does anyone control my work products but me. I decide where I'm going to work and where I spend my money. So people think they're entitled to a job forever, especially labor unions. They're always marching around screaming about how they might be laid off. Well, you know, sometimes we don't need certain things. We don't need bank tellers as much anymore because we have ATM machines. In a civil society, you always have a plan B. If people don't want to trade with you anymore, you're not entitled to a job forever. The government's not there to create jobs for you and protect your job with a bailout. You have to find someone else who's willing to trade with you. Maybe if you're taking piano lessons, you only want to learn enough about piano to accompany your choir at church. You don't want to become a competitive pianist. So is your piano instructor entitled to a job forever? Or should he think of a plan B, another career to come up with? We're always changing jobs, but that's part of progress. That instability I call progress. And rich people, the 1%, are not privileged. They're not fortunate. They're not greedy. Going back to the leisure, I picked leisure over work example. We do not call people who choose leisure lazy, and people who seek out work opportunities, we don't call them greedy versus lazy. We don't use those terms in economics. We just say people make choices. Did you understand what I said? And so we can all be rich, but you know, some people, I like my leisure time. I'll never be a neurosurgeon. That's fine. Government exists to protect our property rights. And the one property right that we do want to have protected is our right to control our own labor supply, our own labor hours. That's the one property right I think even socialists would agree an individual should have protected and control exclusively. Because if someone else controls your labor, what is that called? That's called slavery. But I just want to mention that there, it's like a spectrum. The government protects your right to have monopoly over your labor, over your website, your name, and your phone number, so you know who you're trading with in the marketplace. But past that, the government can actually protect you from competition, from entry by better, more able competitors. Is that an essential right, or is that protectionism? That would be excessive government. That would be government intervention, excessive government interference with the economy. Now, there's a spectrum here, just to mention this. Copyrights and patents are given out to inventors who invent a new product. You want to encourage innovation. If they can't capture the revenue from inventing a new product, that's the argument, then they will not bother inventing. So we have these short-term monopolies, these patents and these trademarks and copyrights to encourage people to, but when is a new invention truly unique enough to warrant protection? That is a good question, I think, because did you just change the color of a coffee machine door and it's someone else's? Was that a truly unique innovation, or was that just changing something slight that someone else did? So I tend to be radical on this. I don't want any like patents to drugs. If you're a drug pharmaceutical company and you invent a new product, if you can keep that secret, you can earn the fruits from that. But if someone can like reverse engineer that, it's over for you. So there is some controversy about when is just regular property rights compatible with a free economy, free enterprise system? When does it become protectionism, like union, coerced unions? And I always ponder that question. I wonder, you know, where's the limit there? I hope you understood that. I don't have all the answers, just most of them. All right. And finally, the government is not there to provide privately consumed goods, just collective goods we all use. So it's not there to give you health care, food, housing. You hear a lot about, well, we got to provide health care for everyone, and of course it's going to get expensive because people don't take care of themselves when the government provides it for free, and all the interest groups rush in hoping that their service will be considered health care related, whether it's like feng shui or acupuncture. It's all going to be in there, and that's why the cost will explode. Even though you don't really want that in your plan, it's in there. So that becomes unsustainable. But to me, the government is not there to provide health care, and it will have to ration. There's only so much money to provide these services, and there'll be so many people making demands. The government will have death panels, as Sarah Palin puts it. But to me, that's not the government's job. We each are our own death panels. When we have someone in the hospital who's sick, and we purchase insurance, and there's a cap usually, how much you can like draw from your policy. Together, we sit together, and you have your grandfather, he's like 90, he's only really sick. And he says, no, I don't need life extension, I'm good. And let's just leave the money for the grandkids' college. So I'm not saying these are easy questions, but they're ours to make. They're difficult, but they're ours. In the UK, the government, it's single payer. The government takes in the money and then allocates services. You cannot use your own assets, your own equity in your house, to take out a loan to get a surgery. You have to get in line with everyone else. But I earned the money, I allocate it. You don't tell me what to do, but that's what'll happen. And maybe the grandfather would say, look, I've had a great life, put the money into, thank you so much, everybody. I want the grandkids to go to a great college. But they might say, no, your great-grandchild's gonna be born next month. We're gonna keep you going, no. So together, they decide that as a family. It's not the government's business. Also, just as a joke, we're not supposed to have sugary drinks now or fast food, as you know, but I had a student say, gee, you know, we need to ban fast food because it causes heart disease and everything all the time, and it's expensive for the government. Why the government's offering the service and then like rationing it out, I don't know, but we need the government to regulate behaviors that are like high cost. But is the goal in life to be a hamster in a cage, running on a wheel, eating rice pellets, and living to 113 and being miserable? Or is it to have fun too? Is to have fun. Is to have a steak every weekend. Maybe I lopped a couple years off the end, but damn it, I had fun. And who weighs the costs and the benefits? We do. And I have to carpool at Pierce, and like we're supposed to like drive with somebody else. No, comrade, I like my own car. As long as I'm not polluting too much, you know, I earn my money. I want to spend my money on my own car, driving by myself. I don't want to. So I'm thinking we have to fill in a bubble every, like, how many people did you drive this week? Was it like by yourself or two? So next time they do this, I'm going to actually go to U-Haul and get one of those, like, trailer hitches and tow another car behind me. So instead of putting one person per passenger, I can put one half. See how they like that? Yeah. Okay, I laughed, but I'm sick of it. Don't tell me how many people to drive with, okay? I'm earning my money, I want a car. Thank you. So you don't tell me what kind of, I have to disagree with Rush Limbaugh. I love him, I listen to him all the time. He said the government's trying to, he said now salt doesn't hurt you, now it does. He said the government's all political, they're trying to like tell you what to do. I don't really agree with that. I think there's a role for information. The government can make sure that the claims on a product aren't fraudulent. And they can warn you if salt's bad, and then you make the choice. They don't advocate what you do, but the information's fine. There's corruption, I agree, they're gonna lie, but well, they're gonna be maybe inaccurate. And we need outside, like referees, like consumer reports. But having said that, I think there's an informational function. The government should make sure that what's on the label reflects as accurately as possible what the service is there that's being provided. The macroeconomics of freedom, the government, now you're going to hear from Democrats that without government there'd be no economy, nobody would work or anything. And you had to have a government, boom, and then finally people start working. No, to me, no, the work came first. A farmer in Ventura and the Northridge mall owner were producing a way. Then they're like, hey, we could trade. Oh, hell, we're going to have a road. That means government. So you see how the production came before the government, and then they had to have collective goods. So I completely disagree. That's how the political science teachers talk. They're like, oh, you need government first. Yeah, no, I don't think so. And they're like, oh, this is so frustrating. We're going to need government. Charity is important in a society with instability and economies rocked by natural disasters. And I agree that we should give to others, but we should not be forced to give to others, and that's where I crossed the line with the Democrats. I crossed out the word forced on the bottom of page 2 right there. At no time does anyone take control of my work products. I control them and I decide who to give to. And I do give a lot of money to my students, to my relatives, but I decide who gets the charity. That's the 13th Amendment. We abolish slavery. Don't vote to take my money and call it like, oh, this democracy. No, that's mob rule, that's tyranny of the majority. Whether it's a dictator or a plurality of voters, no. And people are big givers in the United States, but come on. Do you see how they make a new right out of a violation of the old rights, and they call it a right to something or other? On page 3, government charity does not increase stability. So if I give someone food stamps, is that stabilizing my situation, or is that making me put me at more risk? I'm placed at more risk because that depletes my nest egg. So you're really stabilizing overall or just shifting the instability around? And if people know they can rent seek and seek government favors, do people still work hard or they just divert energies into lobbying the government? And then no one's working. So if you know good fences make good neighbors and you cannot take from your neighbor through the political process to meet your needs, people's behavior changes. They start taking more care of business, they go to Pearson and take classes if they need a job, their behavior radically changes. So the institutions involving the welfare state truly affect incentives and motivation to work, and it's a very corrosive effect. And then people feel entitled to it. This is charity. This isn't like a right. This is forced charity. And we can see the effects. 16 trillion in debt. It's actually 200 trillion by one account because of the liabilities for Medicare and Social Security. It's huge. And I'm just worried. Last time we spoke, my mood was very dark, and my attitude has not lightened one bit. I'm very worried about what's going to happen. Still, the government's borrowing. I think the stock market's going to do very poorly because eventually we're not going to keep borrowing. They're going to cut us off. And either interest rates will go up, or we're going to have to start paying off some of that debt. And if we do, are people going to have money to go to the movies and out to dinner, spend in the firm's products, or are they going to have to give it to the government? So are firms going to be getting revenue and profits or not? So that's coming. It's like, can't go on forever. Now, government charity produces more insolvency and debt due to the moral hazard problem. It doesn't just shift costs around, it actually worsens the instability in the economy because people think it's free, so they use more of it. And then you have unsustainable entitlement programs. Does government create jobs or do consumers? Who decides who's a useful resource? The consumers every day. The government doesn't create jobs. The government pays for people but to dig ditches and fill them in again, but we decide what has value to us, valuable output. So I tell my students, don't be spun by the politicians. They'll say, oh gee, we have unemployment. I'll say, who's unemployed? They'll say, oh, that bank teller. I say, no, that's not an unemployed resource. That's just an annoying person. We have full employment. We need dental assistance. That's what we need. Consumers' values drive what employment means, not the government. But Nancy Pelosi said, well, we should give up more welfare and food stamps because they spend it at the stores and stuff and it creates jobs. I'm like, oh my God, are you stupid? Because you're taking my money, so now I can't spend it over there. So you create a job over here, but now you lose one over there because I couldn't spend it. What? Creates jobs, really? It's like floats down from the heavens, you know? It's amazing. I'm just stunned. So, no economy is perfectly stable, and I don't think it should be because we constantly have entrepreneurship innovating, and that's part of progress. Compulsory unions are not a right. It's a violation of rights to decide your own contract. But they say, oh, we have a right to collective bargaining. Yeah, if it's voluntary, it never is. And it's also bad for consumers because it takes away their rights to pick the best teachers at Pierce. Pensions are savings accounts. A pension is not a paycheck that never ends. It's a savings account of finite size. And a lot of people don't save enough, so they expect the taxpayers and the students to backfill over time their pensions. And, well, I have a contract. You can't violate my contract. But what about the social contract we have with our own students in class? They have the same reasonable tax rates that we've enjoyed all these decades. You're kicking the can down the road to them. What about the contract we have with them to enjoy low tax rates and start their own life? So when you enforce the labor union's unending pensions, you're violating contracts with young people coming up. And I'm just giving you some talking points because you're going to hear things like this when you talk with people about politics. I don't want to go through this in too much detail, but before we the economy can grow, we have to stop consuming and save and put it into better technology, and then the economy expands. A lot of Democrats say we just have to spend more, spend. But spending, borrowing to spend on consumption is not going to grow the economy, but investing it will. So you have to reduce consumption today and then build a new net to catch fish, and then you'll get more fish in the future. Spending by itself is not going to grow the economy. It's just like eating your seed corn, and that's a confusion you see a lot. The Keynesian model, which the Keynesians are Democrats, and they say the government's role is to bank surpluses during good times, save money for a rainy day, and then when the economy goes sour, like there's a drought, or foreign cars are better than ours, so we have unemployed workers, then we use that surplus, and they run deficits, and they dig into the surplus to retrain people. Now, why is the government holding the surplus? Why can't we all hold our own surpluses in the bank? And they never hold it, it's gone. They spend it. So, you know, give me a break. But these are economic, mainstream economic concepts. The government's here to stabilize things. Yeah, what a scam. When the Fed prints money and puts it in the banks, it does lower interest rates. It makes it more affordable to borrow and take mortgages out. You don't have to pay as much in interest, so it frees up money for other things. But the person that makes those loans, the investors, the bondholders, are they getting the same return or less? So are they able to spend as much, or are you spending it now? So if your interest is lower, you get money to spend on other things. But now, do they get the same interest payments to you or less? So are they spending the same amount or less? So overall, are we spending more or the same? Yeah, it's the same, and also no one saves anymore because there's no return. So I don't get the Fed's helping to expand the economy. No, people or bondholders are eating cat food right now. Thank you. That's not helping at all. And it helps certain groups. There's winners and losers with the government. With free trade, both people win. When the government, there's always winners and losers, and there are disincentive effects going on. Okay, so unfunded mandates. Just let me check my time here. Unfunded mandates. We have a lot of legislation passed for like highway construction, border security, but do they actually fund all those activities? No, they pass a law and then they don't enforce the laws. So there are so many unfunded mandates. It's like mystery meat, what you're going to get no matter who you elect, whether it's Democrat or Republican, because there are so many unfunded projects. They can pick and choose what policies and regulations they're going to enforce. So you have no idea what you're going to get once they get into office. And that's because they should actually plan to fund what they pass or don't pass it at all. And all that institutional noise creates a lot of uncertainty in the economy. And then people are like, gee, should I save money or am I going to be a GM bondholder and not get any money back? Because the unions had to get repaid for their... When the government doesn't enforce voluntary contracts that we agree to, it creates uncertainty and then people stop lending. You can only do that once. So I see people holding cash, just not sure if the government's going to honor their contracts. And it's destroyed the capital market. It's very serious. Now, on page 4, I'm going to quickly go through some news articles. These are just fun things I use in my classes to show the benefits of free enterprise and the dangers and immorality of socialism, central planning of the economy, economic activities. On page 4, there's the example of the new technology. The farmer, he cut his fertilizer costs down by putting in GPS so that he saves money. So what happens to his costs? They're lower, and so that gap's profit. And now everyone else is going to imitate him. That profit is a price signal. Hey, look what I just did. All the other farmers are going to lower their costs, and because they compete, price comes down too. So profit is a reward for technological innovation and for innovating new products and stealing everyone's customers. Yes, because you have a better product. And these are ebb and flows. When you see profit, you say, hopefully you're not protected by the government, okay? It's like it's not monopoly profits. You did something everyone loves. We can't just be happy for them. Yay, good for you. You say, oh, you made some money. Oh, really? Well, go imitate him. Compete with him. There's a solution. Well, call your congressman. And then they actually invented a new way to make our bridges so we might get a tax cut. Well, that'll never happen. They actually mix bacteria into cement. When the bridges crack, they just water the bridges and the bacteria grows and fills in the cracks. That is so awesome. So now you're freed up to spend, you don't have to pay as much in taxes for rebuilding the bridges. So all these little changes help us get more out of our resources. We don't have to have as much late, we have more leisure time. It's great. And leftists, they never see this. They're like, you made some money, or gee, I don't know why he's rich. It's because he's skilled and he cut his costs. Look at him. And so on page 5, slipping ahead. So if you want to become prosperous in a free enterprise system, or in any economy really, should you major in a science or should you major in feminist accordion music of the 1700s? Which you think has a bigger market value to customers? So you could live in your dad's basement when you're 40 because you just picked that major. And it's really outrageous. The government will fund, through the government, they fund education, which shouldn't be nationalized. And they'll fund majors that nobody wants because the banks would take the risk and they'd make sure it was a profitable major. So there's a lot of people who are unemployed and they're just told, oh yeah, you should be majoring in that. But there's no market for that. It's just an expensive hobby. I tell my students, pick something useful. Then on page 6, that's just a chart that shows that, I know it's kind of busy and hard to read in here, but on page 6 it shows you that on the left, life expectancy is higher in countries with the most freedom. That's what page 6 shows on the left. And life expectancy is a good proxy for how prosperous people are, how the quality of the food, medicine, and so forth. So this shows you, when banks compete, you win. When you keep hospitals and farmers and grocery stores and electronics companies competing, they're always trying to cut the cost to bring you in the door. You get more out of your resources and you're prosperous. South Korea at night, completely lit up. Google Maps North Korea, completely dark. Because they're not getting efficient use out of the resources, because you're not pushing these firms to compete for your money. And so on page 7, let me see. I gave a help session to my students this morning for 4 hours, so my voice is pretty shot today. On page 7, you can see population is growing around the world, but also life expectancy. So things are getting better all the time. We shouldn't be so negative. Things do improve. And then I'll flip it over to page 8 that just shows you that workers are more productive as they get better tools. They can produce more each hour. It doesn't take 5 hours to produce a loaf of bread. It only takes 20 minutes or 5 seconds. And on page 9, you can see that even though we do have government provide certain public goods, maybe like the water supplies, something government might manage because we all use water pipes under the streets. Can we benefit from competitive bidding for those contracts? Can taxpayers take advantage of that? So even though it's collectively paid for through taxation, we can still benefit by making the different private firms compete for the contract. And in Argentina, they privatized the water system. Privatized, that means it was competitive. My colleagues hate the word privatized. It's like, you know, it's like competitive. It's good. It brings out excellence. So, oh yeah, because I'm an activist as well as a scholar, I need to remember Alinsky's rules. 5 is sarcasm, your best weapon, and 6 is use tactics your people like. So this is my license plate, privatize. That means make competitive, don't subsidize. Give it to a crony you like. Yeah, this is, what a nerd, I know. So there's so many benefits to competition, and all of the college teachers, they all send their kids to private schools. What a joke. I'm gonna flip it to page 10. Oh, there's Ben Carson. He's dreaming. Love him. So you can see that in Britain, the costs have gone so high because everything's unionized in the healthcare sector that it's very costly to get anything done. They have like a separate union for a quarter turn of the light bulb that they decided, oh man, maybe if we outsource it to competing firms, we can get lower costs. Now, when you have a lower cost service, it doesn't mean you're exploited. For example, as a teacher, you might use Excel spreadsheets to grade, and you get it done more quickly. So are you exploited because you're being paid less for the same job, or are you being paid less because you get it done more efficiently in less time? So you're not exploited. I win, you win. So they're always like playing that, I'm exploited card. But apparently they've discovered competition works in Great Britain. And then on the next page, page 11, oh, that's the downward spiral of socialism. When you declare a private good a right, that everyone's entitled to health care or whatever, then everybody wants it, so demand goes up. People don't take as good a care of themselves. And the services go up. Every interest group in the world wants their service included in health care. And that's why it's going to be unsustainable, insolvent, and it's going to bankrupt the country. Because, you know, mental health, that's important too. So don't we all need a vacation sometimes? So do you think the hotel industry would like to be part of healthcare services? We're all gonna die here. It's an unbelievable. And mental health, that's another one that's gonna be big, like fear of cats. Okay, you can be unemployed. So there's and of course, these are all unionized workers, and they all give percentage of their union dues to the Democrat Party. That's why this is happening. But it's going to break the taxpayers' backs. It's unbelievable. So this is just the what happens under, oh, it sounds good. Oh, no, then we're North Korea. On page 12, they actually cut basic services in the UK healthcare system. They're restricting basic treatments because they can't afford everything. People are doing do-it-yourself dentistry. And on page 13, let me see. So in the UK, they make you use the bed sheets twice to save money. Because they ran out of money, because everyone's not taking care of themselves, plus all the industries think they're part of healthcare, so they can't afford everything. And in Germany, they have unemployment insurance that's nationalized, where the government provides unemployment insurance for people. And people took so long to find work, because it was like, hey, it's like free, I'll just go on unemployment, that the government's like, oh no, you gotta go back to work, because we need you to pay taxes. So prostitution's legal in Germany. So this girl, she's like a waitress or something, she's unemployed, and they said, oh comrade, now look, there's an opening as a prostitute. You're going to have to take that because we can't afford to keep. So you see how it sounds really good on paper? Yeah, government's going to pay. But then the government runs out of money. It's like, then they tell you what to do. It's like total slavery. Have a nice day. Okay. And then on page 14, So in North Korea, the government runs the health, the farming system, and they have droughts over there. And they don't want anybody to know what's going on, because when there's bad news, the government doesn't want a revolution. They want to keep power. So they never tell you the true facts and data about unemployment or output. And they took away people's phones, so they can't communicate bad news to each other. So you start to lose all kinds of human rights under socialism, because they're not huge brains. They're just people like us. We should let specialists in a free market do these things. You get more if we're all specialists. Don't try to run the economy. You're hurting everyone. So, okay, and then on page 15, I show that before we had the government helping out people with welfare, huge welfare programs, people actually had private insurance. So I have books back here. I'm not going to get them out. But in the 1919s, many minority working families were part of these, they were called mutual aid societies, where they would give a dollar a month, and if something happened, they were taken care of. And as you can see, 90, 80, 90% of these families. Now, if the government provides it, would you bother doing that? But if the government doesn't, might you figure out to do something like this, like join a church group? Or so people find out ways, and they're much more efficient. They don't let anybody waste money or be corrupt. And then on page 16, you can see that poverty was falling before the welfare state, because people were actually joining these groups. It was like private insurance, helping each other out. It only started to creep up after Johnson's Great Society programs went in. So I tell my liberal friends, the goal is to minimize poverty, right? What system is most conducive to doing that? A private charitable organization, where they make sure you're actually sick or infirm, or government, where it encourages dependency? Which one is minimizing poverty here? And of course, when you're on welfare, you have kids, and there's more people on welfare. So the goal is to minimize poverty. I think we can agree on that. And then finally, this is just me joking around, but so on page 17, it says sitting less may add 2 years to your life expectancy. I'm like, oh boy, I think I'll walk to work from now on. I don't want to sit in the car. Now, why sit down at a movie on the weekend? I just walk around and like walk over to Chatsworth from Northridge. So I crossed out sitting more and I put adds enjoyment. Do you see what I did? Yeah, because like, there's benefits to sitting. I don't want to walk and be all like, my knees are all cut up and this bug's biting me and I'm like walking all the time. I like sitting. And then cancer rates skyrocket in Asia. So they're having more fun foods, McDonald's food, not just rice every day. And it does escalate the rate, the potential for cancer, like 30 years down the road in the long run. But are they having more enjoyable foods too? So I put fun expected to skyrocket. I know that was dark, but the point is, they're living longer, they're getting nutrition, there's a little carcinogen, but boy, I was so good, and I got nutrients, and you know, things change, eventually we'll have cures for these things, and everybody takes risks. So I'm just about done. I just wanted to touch on those themes today, and I also wanted to mention, back on page, all the way back to the, I have some further reading suggestions on the last page there. Oh, and there's Walter Williams. And then I have some quotes in the back. They're really good quotes. You might want to read those later. So let me just go back to page 3. And the last time we met, I had questions about, like, what's wrong with Democrats, you know? Why do they hate rich people? And why are they so big on the welfare system? So why do they hate free enterprise so much? Why do they hate capitalism so much? I said, well, I love free enterprise. To me, when people go to the business school at CSUN, they're the heroes, the business students, because they're going to set up a restaurant that could fail. They can't force you in that door, like the post office. Is the post office like have competition? They have some, but not. It's legally required that you mail first class mail through the post office. So who's really greedy? The small business person or the postal system? Because they're protected from competition. So I'm telling these business majors, you're heroes to me. You go. Just don't take subsidies, but you're good. Thank you for trying. And it's so sad when some of these businesses fail, because you might have a great restaurant, but someone just slightly better. And then you work for them. But it's all part of bringing out the best. So at the very bottom of page 3, just to mention why people continue to hate free, decentralized economies and limited government, They are concerned about crony capitalism, for example, and we already agreed that's not part of free enterprise, so we can dispel that immediately. They're also concerned about past historical wrongs, like when colonists came to the United States and maybe took land that belonged to Indians, indigenous peoples. Now, I'm totally into that. I give that all to the left. Now, a lot of land was unincorporated, okay? Nobody was on the land, so don't tell me you stole someone's farm, because a lot of cases it wasn't true. But in some cases, it was true. Like the Spanish colonists went into South America and they looted the people. They took all their gold and their farmland, they put them in like detention centers and prison camps. And that's not the rule of law. So we have to, as Dennis Prager says, every social movement has a grain of truth to it. You have to do, but the problem with President Obama is he says, we're going to tax rich to help out the disadvantaged and historically disadvantaged. So now I want to set up a moral ledger, okay? So you were wronged because you were a slave, but did we have $15 trillion in new in great society spending after Lyndon Johnson? Did we have that? So how much compensation is enough? Do you see how you're giving it, but then you're like, what about this? And with slavery, how many people died in the Civil War trying to free the slaves? So that was wrong, but what about that gift, that return that was given? So you have to look at both sides of that ledger, and you can come to some resolution. But you can't just say, oh, you guys are just crazy leftists, because they're not totally crazy, although they're kind of crazy. Some of them, I mean, they hate rich people. I'm like, oh my God, you don't know. Take my class. But sometimes, now, do we want to tax all rich people for past injustices to give to historically disadvantaged? Or just like the sugar and like the towel and cotton companies that benefited from slavery. So if we're going to provide restitution, we should do it surgically. President Obama said, we're going to make advances in this society, but it's not going to be, it's going to be imperfect. By that he means we're going to tax everybody, all people, rich people, whether they had a cotton factory to compensate past wrongs or whether they were part of the Underground Railroad. And those people, they gave a lot. They weren't part of the slave trade. So I say we get on ancestry.com, we look up, hey, it's good, I've used it. We look up who had ancestors, who benefited from the cotton and sugar industries, and not all minority groups are victims of slavery. Did certain, like, African tribes, were they complicit in the slave trade? Did they help people to enslave people and catch them? So not everybody who is in a minority group is a victim. But I'm into restitution. We don't need to transform society. We have an app for that, the Constitution. Okay, so as you can see, I try to reach across the aisle, as it were, and give points where they're due. But we've had many people serve in the military to provide freedoms, and they've lost entire families. And they don't even want to look at that. You know, like, that's a real sacrifice to promote freedom. And we've paid a lot in welfare programs over the years, free education. That's there for you to use. At some point, that's enough. And then class warfare, they think the economy is like a fixed pie, and like when you get more, I get less, which is a fallacy. Resource monopolies, some people get to the gold mine first or the farmland first, and they think that's unfair because there's a resource monopoly. And they said they're like warlords, they're landlords. I said, the person who finds the copper mine first, did he have to expend effort and energy to get there and risk and like calories to find it and resources and had to hire a mule and like put a little, you know, wagon on there? So when he finds it in the wilderness, he wasn't taking it from someone else. That land is the real income from that labor effort. It's not your land. Get out of here. But you're not lost. You're not going to be poor, because if you know plant genetics, you can merge your skills with him and double the yield. See, they're both equally sovereign. They're not one's better than another. They both, in a free trade, you're both equally sovereign. I can help you and you can help me. So you can still make a living. You're just not the landowner with no skills. So we argue. One guy goes, well, that's like a warlord, that you have a land with a gun in my face. I said, it's called the Second Amendment. You see what I did right then? Yeah. Oh, they hate me at Pierce. They don't hate me, but they're like, they're not really sure whether they agree or not. And I said, that's okay. Just think about it. You know, I love discussing these things. And then finally, the economy is going camping. Collectivists think the economy would be better if we just, from each according to his ability to each according to his need. And everybody works, and then we take from the collective pile of stuff as needed. It's like a camping trip, they said. You pick blueberries, and you fish, and then I collect wood. And then we just take and share. It's like a big hippie camping exercise. I said, we don't need any prices or markets or accounting costs and prices. We don't need any of that. Just share the wealth. We don't need, like, money or anything. I said, but if I pick the blueberries and I'm trading, basically there is a trade going on. When I put the blueberries in, I'm exchanging it for your fish. There's a trade. Wouldn't it be better if I could have two different fishermen to pick from instead of one, and then have choices? Like, I call competition production diversity, so that, you know. See, I'm into the language. I'm pretty sneaky, yeah. So wouldn't it be better if you had two different fishermen instead of one, say, run factory fishing? And then you could compete for my blueberries, and you could lower your costs and give me the freshest fish. And there, boom, and you want to have accountants, because that's how you know if you're measuring efficient technological change, cutting your resource usage. Accountants are very important. And then we know direction, prices are signals, and boom, you're off. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed that introduction, and thanks.